This whole world may hold me down, but it can never drown you out. I'm not merely flesh and bone. I was made for something.
Well, hey, good morning, Gateway. If you're at home, you probably can't tell, but people are cheering. We're able to get out of the smoke and worship together. It's difficult times, but it is good to see you. We want to just welcome you. We want to ask that as you come in, that we all apply our protocol and do what we can to continue to make this a safe place. But we are just excited that not only do we get to worship, but we get to worship together for those of you that are here. And if you're at home, we're going to welcome you into our morning message. I want to ask a few things of you. First of all, if you are at home, go ahead and click on the subscribe button that you'll see on your screen. That will allow us to be able to communicate with you and do best at what we're trying to do with everybody online. A couple of other announcements that I want to share with you this week. The small groups are beginning today. In fact, this week we begin our small groups, and we're going through this great study called Transformed. And I want to just take a moment, because if you haven't signed up, there's still time. You can go to our website, click on small groups. There are other groups you can sign up to be a part of. Some are online, some are in person with the correct amount of people. And I just want to share this little idea. I've had this picture, and I shared it with my small group this week, that I feel like, now, if you're a surfer, you wouldn't understand this, but surfing takes a little time to get out onto the waves. And once you get to the waves, you got to work to get and find that wave that you're going to ride, that surfing wave. I feel like what's happening now is we're all surfing, but so many people have gone beyond the break, and they're missing the wave. And COVID has kind of allowed us all to lull ourselves to sleep. And many people are just drifting. And many people in the church are just drifting because, well, we can't worship, or we can't see people, and I can't do this, and I can't do that. And yet, I believe now is a time that we need to work, because if you're a surfer, you need to work to get on the wave. You need to work to ride that wave. And when you get there, the adventure even begins much greater than if you're just lulled to sleep and kind of go out to the ocean. I want to challenge you, if you're part of Gateway Community Church, even if you're not, you just tune in online, check out the small groups and sign up for a small group. We'll get you a great book. This book will allow you to take notes with the Sunday morning service, connect with the study each week, and connect, more importantly, with the number of people who you will be able to ride the wave of your faith journey at this season, which is very difficult, and you need people. We want to make that available to you. I know Pastor Al will touch on that a little bit more. It seems like I had one other announcement, offering. We are going to have offerings today. During the worship, this is how we take offering. During the worship time, at some point, you're going to see baskets in the back. One, two, three baskets. Feel free to get up during worship and just take your offering. It's an opportunity of worship, and this is what we're here to do. I think of Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Romans 12, verse 1 and 2, the theme verse for this study that we're doing, says this: "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper act of worship. Don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Let me pray. Father, today as we have gathered to worship, God, you are the one, you are the authority that we want to abide and listen to and follow above all others. And yet we have authority on this place that you've told us to submit to. God, allow us to be able to do that in a way that is honoring you, but also honoring those authorities, and yet treating people, helping people because of the need to meet together. Father, I ask that you would allow this morning to be one that is solely focused upon you, that you would allow this morning to be one that blesses us by the teaching of your word, and that the music that we share with you, that we lift up to you, God, honors you and praises you and gives you all glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you stand with us this morning? And for those of you at home, you're welcome to stand right where you are as well and join us as we worship.
Bow out. great King of glory.
Who is the great King of glory? Seated on high in the heavens, oh, Jesus, you alone. You are the Lord God Almighty, strong.
Our praise to you this morning. To Jesus alone, we give our praise, we give our thanks. God, we thank you for your presence. God, we feel you here in this place. God, we ask that your presence would permeate every living room, every bedroom, every kitchen, wherever people are watching from. Lord, we just ask that your presence would be felt there. God, we ask that as Al comes up to speak this morning, that his words would be your words, God. That you would speak through him, Lord, that he would say what he needs to say, hold back what doesn't need to be said just yet, God, and that we would take those words from you and apply them to our lives and live our lives out differently because of them, because of you. God, we thank you for the gift of praise, that when we praise, when we lift our eyes to you, God, that our circumstances go there too, Lord, that our trials go there too. We thank you that you help us carry them, Lord. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Man, it's good to see people back here. I don't know exactly what we're going to be doing next week. It depends a lot on air quality and so on, but it's good to see you. Do I get a five? All right. Thank you, buddy. Oh, Lord bless you, bud. How you doing? Oh, you want another five? Okay. All righty. All right. We are happy to be back. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. All right. Well, I just want to welcome you, whether you're online here or in person. But it's good to be able to worship God, and we're starting a special series. We had kind of an intro to it last week, and this morning we're talking about the first of the seven areas of transformation. If you have your book already with you, if you got one at home, you got one here, if you open up at the very front there, they've got on pages 2, 3, and 4, there's some open pages here for an outline, so you could take message notes each week. I would just encourage you. And I know this is the first Sunday, so a lot of you don't even have your book yet, right? But I encourage you to bring your book with you, excuse me, and then take notes. And then throughout the week, there are readings, and there's an outline that you fill in with Rick Warren's video message. Really good stuff. For this morning, if you don't have your book already, if you haven't gotten one, we have some outlines distributed, but there are some more back there. And if you're online, you can get on our website, gatewaymerced.org. And you can get hold of the outline there. Especially this first week, I realized I might need to do that an extra kind of special way that way. Wanted to invite you to pray with me, and we're going to dive in, okay? Father God, thank you so much that we have this opportunity. Thank you for worship. Thank you for the music. Thank you for opportunities to be together online or in person. Thank you for all the work that's gone into making it possible for us to be able to have live streaming and all the tech work that's been done, all the modifications that have been done, all the giving that's helped to make that happen. But now this morning, we especially thank you for your word. And as Sherry was asking, we just pray that you'd come and you'd fill our hearts, fill our minds, guide us, we pray, into your truth. Teach us, help us to be transformed to be like you, Jesus. Amen. Our verse, our theme verse for this whole series is Romans 12. And if you would read that out loud with me online or here, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let's read it again. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The key to transformation starts not in your actions, but in your thoughts. you get your thoughts changed, and then you can get your emotions changed. And then if you get your thoughts and your emotions changed, you have a lot better chance of the actions changing. And so we're going to take this principle, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And we want to, Lord willing, over the next 7 weeks, apply this to the seven major areas of our lives. To our spiritual transformation, physical, emotional, relational, vocational. We want to try to have our entire lives be transformed. Transformation changes us, really, from emptiness to fullness. It changes us from being people who are afraid, people who are timid, who are weak, into people who have the boldness and the courage of Christ. Because it helps us to become more like Jesus. It helps us to live into the plan that the Creator God made us for, and that Jesus came here to die for. And so what I want to say this morning is, as we get started, I want to talk about spiritual transformation. And let's be really clear. If you're not spiritually transformed, if you don't become more and more like Jesus and start in the spiritual area, the farther away from God you're living, the more miserable you're going to be. The farther away from God you get into a bigger and bigger mess. It's a rocky, rocky, chaotic kind of a road that you're trying to live. But also, on the other hand, the closer you get to God, the more transformed life you're going to live. Now, I'm not saying easy. We don't preach here, teach here, that if you say yes to God, then, oh, everything's going to be peachy keen the rest of your life, you know, all that kind of. That's not what the Bible says. But God is with you, and He walks you through no matter what it is that happens in your life, and you will become more like Christ. No matter what else is going on, in the middle of the chaos, you'll be not conformed to the chaos, but transformed by God. So, at least at the core, I believe that every single one of us really wants to be close to God. You might not even be conscious of that fact right now. You might be watching at some place. Maybe you're here for some reason, but you're not even aware of the fact that you want to be close to God, but I think you really do, because otherwise I don't think you'd be here. I don't think you'd be still watching 3 minutes into this thing if you didn't really want to be transformed, to be like God. But the Bible says, the problem is that all we like sheep have gone astray. Anybody can say, yep, done that, been there, done that? I really know that. Okay, anybody know what my last name, Schaap, means? All right, sheep, yeah, yeah. Sometimes people say Schaap, and it's like, well, that's close to sheep. It's probably okay, but it's actually, it says Schaap, but it means sheep. I know this. Sheep tend to wander. They're not the smartest of animals. You don't have to teach a sheep to take a, you know, to wander off, be ready to fall off a cliff, get stuck in whatever. And it says, actually, it's not just the Schaaps, all of us, you, me, we, all of us, like sheep, tend to wander away. We don't tend to stay close to God. We tend to drift. But if we've fallen, if we've wandered, how do we get back? Well, fortunately for us, there's this great story that Jesus tells. And it's called a parable, right? And I'm going to read the first part of the story. The latter part of the story is another lesson for another day, really, in a sense. But it has some specific principles. I'm going to read the story and then get some principles out of it of how to get back if you've wandered far away from God. How to help your friend back if your friend has wandered far away from God, okay? It's found in Luke chapter 15. It's a third of three stories that Jesus tells, all with the basic same theme of something that gets lost, and then the owner of that goes out looking for it, and then there's the comeback, and there's this terrific rejoicing that happens. Luke 15 started at verse 11. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my,'" just leave, okay, repeat that, "give me my." That's where we get into trouble a lot of times. Give me my, give me my, give me my. Give me my share of the estate. Now, this guy is extraordinarily rude. His dad's not dead yet. And he's saying, "Hey, I actually don't want to wait for you to kind of kick the bucket and get out of the way. I'd really like to have what I'm going to get anyway at some point." So the dad's, you know, "I'm not going to make you stay around here." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he'd spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I'll set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf, kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine,'" not servant, "'this son of mine,' he took him back, "'was dead and is alive again. Excuse me, 'He was lost and is found.'" So they began to celebrate. Now I said, there's a bit more to the story. The older brother is not willing to come in and celebrate with him. That's another part of the story for another time. But this part gives us some really good clues of how to get back to Father if you've wandered away or if your friend has wandered away. This last Thursday, my wife Jolene went down to Fresno to help our daughter with the kids. Some of you remember when Jet was born. He's 4 now, but he was in the hospital in the NICU for 4 months. And a lot of you guys were praying for him. And now he's a little spitfire, and he's all going at it like crazy. But we've also got twin grandkids, and they just turned 2. Yeah. You know what they call the 2-year-olds, right? Terrible 2s. Well, we prefer the teachable 2s, the trainable 2s. I think we should change it to the transformable 2s. You know, that might work, right? But she gets home Thursday night and she says, "Twins picked up another word. Uh-oh." Yeah, it's that word. I know what you're thinking. Mine. 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 Remember, was it Finding Nemo? The seagulls are going, "Mine, mine, 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 mine." And it's like, yeah, that was a good insight. It's kind of like, that's one of the worst words if you use it in the wrong way. Mine. Because it kind of ushers hollering and crying, even as a 2-year-old, all the way to a 102-year-old, into the world of self-centeredness and give me my, give me my, give me my. And so the younger son in Jesus' story hasn't grown out of that self-centeredness yet. He wants to have his own way, get his own stuff, and do things his way. His theme song is, "I Did It My Way," and he's going to do it his way. And he gets a long, long way away from God, a long, long way from his family, a long, long way from home, and he gets into a mess. The farther away you get from God, the more into a mess you get, right? Give me mine. That's usually where we go off track, and life starts to go downhill into the gullies. Give me mine. So he takes up. Packs off. Now he's doing things that his dad wouldn't let him do when he was there. But pretty soon he's so messed up, he hits the skids, he's homeless. And then there's a national recession because this pandemic, it's a pan famine here, hits and nobody has anything anywhere. And he can hardly find a job, and he finally gets a job feeding pigs for a farmer. Now, I grew up in Iowa, and on a farm with lots of different animals, and they all have their own stink. Pigs have the worst stink of all. It's a stink that just kind of hangs on you. You know, I used to, had to do that every once in a while. You have to clean it out. You have to feed the pigs. It just kind of hangs on you, right? Well, for this guy, it's even worse because he's a Jewish boy. And if you know some of the story of how God has his people, for a Jewish person, pigs are considered unclean. You're not even supposed to touch those things. You can't eat them. And here he is, a Jewish boy, taking care of pigs, slopping pigs. And he's like, what in the world am I doing here? He says he came to his senses. What have I done? How did I get here? How did I get myself into this? Anybody ever have that? How did I get to this mess? Ever have this thought? You're going to have wine, women, and song, and instead all you really got is pig slop, pig stink, and just a whole lot of stomach growling. How did I get into this mess? And nobody's even given him anything to eat. Nobody's given him that next hit. Nobody's given him that next thing for his to feed his addictions. And he finally comes to his senses and he says, here's the plan. I'm going to go back to Dad. I know I don't deserve to be called his son anymore, but maybe he'll take me back as a hired hand. I'll just try that. And if you've ever wandered off, let me point out a couple of things that he did. Okay, the way back, first thing is he got fed up. He got sick and tired of all the junk. He got tired and disgusted with the circumstances of his life. He's too stressed. He's too lonely. He's too miserable. And I want to tell you, friends, it's not like anything's really going to happen in your life to change your life in the next 7 weeks if you don't somewhere in one of these areas of your life say, I've had enough of that. I need to let God transform me. I am sick of this mess. And unless you get fed up, unless you get sick of whatever's going on where you're not in sync with God, you might as well like not even participate in this because you probably aren't going to do much. But you start by getting fed up and saying, I'm sick of this. I don't like this. I'm tired of the failure. I'm tired of being here. And you get desperate. You get hungry for change, right? So he gets fed up. Second thing is then you need to wake up. He finally came to his senses, it says. He woke up to what was really going on, to the mess that he was in. It's like, how did I get here? And then ask a question. Are you there yet? Have you gotten woken up to the mess that you're in, to realize what's going on? Has God sounded the wake-up call to you yet? But more, have you listened to that wake-up call? Because he usually sounds that call, but we don't necessarily listen. I mean, if you're not there yet where you're saying yes to what God has, I mean, that's okay, I guess. You know, you can wait. God has ways to send a little bit more difficulty. He can make it rain a little bit more. And if you don't wake up, if you don't pay attention, he's got ways of like getting some good storms brewing. That doesn't work. He can blow the door off your house. Some of you have had some of that happening. All the loss and stuff. Some of you guys have been living even in 2020. I mean, it's reality is we have wake-up calls. I got a friend here, Ken. Why don't you come up here once, please, grab this. Ken is he's a buddy of mine who works as a chaplain out at, USP Atwater. And on Wednesdays, a lot of times, we as ministry leaders from churches and other ministries, we get together. And Wednesday on Zoom meeting, Ken was mentioning something that got me thinking. It's like he was saying that he has conversations a lot of times with these guys who are lifers, and some of them are serial killers, and that he's learned a number of things from the serial killers of how God works. And I'm thinking, now that'd be a good one, you know, a whole series, lessons from serial killers, you know. But what struck me is, Ken, you're talking about how even with the lifers, even with the serial killers, they heard God somewhere.
Absolutely. Is this my, there we go.
Yeah.
we were talking the other day, and let me say this. Where's that worship leader at? Where did she go?
Sherry. Sherry. She's back there. She's hiding.
Wow.
She's hiding. Yeah.
Wow. 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 I came here with a Dixie cup. Remember the little Dixie cups back years ago?
Mm-hmm.
To drink and worship? And I realized that my Dixie cup wasn't big enough. I should have brought a keg. Thank you. That the worship is sweet here.
What's a keg? I don't know.
A keg. Well, I wasn't always saved. See, he leaped in his mama's womb. I wasn't. You know, being the pastor at the USP Atwater out there, we do get an opportunity to ask certain questions of inmates. And one of which was, I always wanted to ask the question, how long did it take you to accept your new reality that you're doing life in prison? And the first guy, I got there about 5 or 6 months. I started out there in 16. He was 30, he was 38, had been down 14 years already. And he said, Chap, it took me 7 years. 7 years. I was like, wow. And then I said, so what changed? He said, when he accepted Christ, it was a complete turnaround. So then my third question, I said, look me in my face and tell me that you never heard a small, still voice. I used the term when you were out there skipping, dipping, and tripping. Some of you are old enough to know what I just said. Skipping, dipping, and tripping. I said, tell me, look me in my face and tell me you never heard a small, still voice tell you not to do the stupid thing that brought you here. And instantly, he started crying. I got guys out there that are pagans. One Caucasian brother tattooed on his back, it says, demon. I got a chance to ask him the same question. Tell me, look me, tell me. You never heard that small, still voice. He said, Chap, I can't. So I discovered something. It took me back. I'm a native San Franciscan, by the way. It took me back to my teens in which I was raising Cain. Some of you know what that means. Fighting all the time. I can remember my friends, hey, Reed, everyone calls me Reed. We're going to go to this party on the other side of San Francisco. Why don't you come? And I heard a small, still voice, don't go. And my reason kicked in, and I went, And what did the boys say? Oh, come on, Reed. Come on, man. You know, if we got to, we know you can handle yourself. And I said, yes, I can. So I went. Bad move. Bad move. Somewhere after the party and the keg, I was leaned up against a wall being patted down. And what did I say to myself? What every one of you said to yourself. Something told me to. I said the exact same thing we all say. Something told me to stay your butt home. But no. When I get upset at myself, I call myself Reed. I'm like, no, Reed, you had to just follow your intellect. And I did. That has happened throughout my life. April 14, 1987 is when I committed my life to the Lord. Amen, somebody. Best, most powerful decision I ever made. So I went to my old high school, and I was jogging around the track. And at some point, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, hey, son. I'm like, yeah, Lord. You remember then when this happened and you got out of it? I'm like, yeah. He goes, that was me. I'm like, really? I'm jogging some more. Remember when this happened in Stockton when you're on that man's land and he shot at you? I said, yeah, I do. He goes, and it didn't hit you. It was me. He walked me back through my life, saints, of all of my ignorant decisions. Now, let me come over to being married. He's the same small, still voice that says, don't you pick this fight with her. Come on. Do we need to have a marriage retreat in here right now? Don't you pick this fight with her. Leave him alone. Back off. Daughter, back off. You're being disrespectful. Leave your wife alone. Leave her alone. But no, ego kicks in. So at some point, we all have to come to our senses and be mindful that that small, still voice has always been, even when I was lost, He has always been the Lord saying, son, come this way. Move into relationship with me. Do not do that. It's going to cost you.
Well, and even now, some of these guys that ignored the voice for a long time got themselves into massive trouble. Mm-hmm. But you're saying this guy said yes to Jesus 7 years in or whatever, right? Even now, no matter the situation, have you seen anybody who said yes to the voice and God said no to them?
You know, that's a powerful question. As a pastor in a high security penitentiary, one would think that, oh, Pastor Ken is going to go out there and just get everybody saved. It's Jesus, 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 right? No, that's not my approach. I want to hear that man own his stuff first. Because why? When we come before the Lord, we have to own that stuff. So these guys out there are loaded. I'm also an Army chaplain. I use the term a rucksack. We get that big backpack. You guys would say backpack. We say it's a ruck. That thing is loaded when we're going from point A to point B. Those guys out there are loaded with stuff in their ruck. So I want to hear them own it. Amen? Somebody say amen. I want to hear them own it. So I lead them very gently into paths of ownership. And when they finally just, now again, this is high security prison. So when a guy is crying in front of me, I have to walk him off because that's saw as weak in prison. So I, hey, come on, man, let's go this way. So I have guys that just, when they own it, I did it, and they just lose it, saints. They lose it. And you could see the Lord just taking the weight out of their ruck, and they just get super light, and then they just ball. So I've seen them ball in ownership of just acknowledging, I did it. I heard a voice tell me not to kill this person. I get to hear that. And I don't know if their attorney will ever hear it. I don't know if the judge is going to ever hear it. But I get to hear them tell me every time, yes, I heard a voice tell me, don't pull the trigger. And I did. And I've been faking it and shunning it all these years until you show up. And I'm like, yeah, that's who I am. So yes, but let's flip the coin. I get the other guy that's no, 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 I'm good. And I'm like, well, then look me in my eye and tell me you never heard the voice. Well, let's, chaplain, what about the Niners last night, man? And I let them change the subject. And I'm like, it was good. It was good. So,
yes, be authentic. Thank you, man.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you,
so
guys.
Much. Thank you.
The worship, sweet.
One of the reasons that I wanted Ken to talk a little bit about that was because I think it is so incredibly important. So you got to get fed up and you got to wake up, hear the voice, then you get up and go to the Father. That's what the Son does. But once you're there, what do? You fess up. You get honest. You tell the truth about what's going on. You confess, yeah, I did it. I did it. I own up to my sins. The Son says, I have sinned against God. I need to face up to the fact that I have done this. In Isaiah, the prophet says, but your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Have you ever prayed and felt like God was a million miles away or like your prayers just barely hit the ceiling and came bouncing back down? Or it's like, you know, the only one talking and the only one listening is me, it kind of feels like sometimes. One of the most likely reasons if that's happening is because you got something going on that you haven't confessed to God. You haven't been honest with him. You got to be, I mean, it's like, Real reconciliation happens when we start to, you know, you write it down, you confess it, you say, okay, no excuses. I did it. I'm sorry. And you know what? when God hears that, he loves to forgive. Also in Isaiah, come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red as crimson, they shall be like wool. The Living Bible paraphrases it like this. It says, come, let's talk this over, says the Lord. No matter how deep the stain of your sins, I can take it out and make you as clean as freshly fallen snow. Even if you're stained as red as crimson, I can make you white as wool. You ever get something with food coloring or whatever into your clothes or into the carpet or something like that and have a hard time getting it out? I'm not gonna say which of our two children we have. A boy and a girl. One of them, when we moved into our house and had this nice light-colored carpet, and it's like really nice carpet. I don't get it. There's this little throw rug there all the time, right by the bed, and maybe it's a prayer rug. I don't know, but it's always there. It's always in the same spot. always there. Finally, this particular child, not saying which one, but he goes, and he's on one of the cameras, so I'm in trouble. He goes to college, and we, you know, toss the rug. He's like, there's a big old honking stain under there. I've been there for like, I don't know, a few years probably. Yeah. That's how we live, though, isn't it? I mean, it's like, I've done that, but I've done it worse. Because, you know, I can try to cover up here, and then I'll try to cover up there, and then I'll get another throw rug here, and I'll get another throw rug for that, and then I'm covering this. Pretty soon, I'm so full of cover-up, throw-up rugs, well, they throw up rugs too, that I'm so covered, you can hardly even tell who I am. God says, let's get rid of all that. Rick Warren calls Isaiah 1:18 the stain remover verse of the Bible. Even if your stain is red as crimson, I can make you white as wool. Just be honest. He says, I can remove that stain. You don't have to deal with that haunting you all the rest of your life. We all have stains. My goodness. Let's let him get them out of here. So we get fed up, we wake up, we get up, we fess up, and then he says, let's have a barbecue. You're back home. Take some of those pigs you were slopping and let's turn them into pulled pork. Well, that wouldn't work for Jews, Jewish people. But let's get the calf. Let's get the fattened calf. And it's time for a barbecue. It's time for tri-tip and ribs and filet mignon. You come home and he runs and he welcomes you. And then all that's really left for you to do is to accept his forgiveness, accept his acceptance, and join the party. Be part of the party. In this context, as I said, there's three stories here in Luke chapter 15, and all of them have someone who lost something that was very precious to them, and they found it, and they celebrate. And they said, come and join us in the celebration. There's this emphasis on the celebration when you come back. The scriptures, you know, Jesus says, there's joy in heaven over one, there's a party in heaven over you when you come back home. We come home for the very first time. And so, yeah, of course we worship. We lift up our praise. Life becomes a party when we get into transformation. Then I would just suggest one more thing. You don't want to run away again or just wander away again. So I would suggest you add one more thing, and that's regular checkups. You just keep on checking up. I mean, I had that stroke a couple months ago, right? So I got to go in tomorrow. They're going to check on my heart to make sure that whatever happened in the carotid here is not messed up there and all that. And this carotid's really good. But what they're going to do is every 6 months, they're going to check it to make sure it's still good. If it's not good, they'll do something about it, right? You all have checkups. You got dental checkups. You got, you know, you're supposed to check your blood pressure. You got to check your blood sugar a few times a day. You got physical checkups every year. You get to a certain age, you're supposed to have your colon checked up. Now, that's a fun one. Can I get a witness? Anybody want to give a testimony right now of how fun that one is? Everything, you know, we do checkups because if you try to get it, you catch anything that's wrong, you catch it early, right? And so if you're clogging up, you got to get that cleared out early. If you got polyps, you got to get removed, get it done early because the sooner is the better, and so that you don't end up with a massive problem. So you regularly do that. We talked last week about setting goals for the week, and I set this one as my goal for this particular week. It was suggested, I think, in some of Rick Warren's material, but it's like, I'm going to do a spiritual checkup today or this week, you could say, then schedule a regular spiritual checkups to make sure I'm continuing in the spiritual transformation process. There's a survey, a health assessment at the back of the book, page 219 and following. I took mine yesterday. There's a couple polyps I need to get rid of, all right? There's a little bit of stuff that's not quite the way it's supposed to be. Pretty good in a lot of areas, but that needs to get taken care of. A couple things, that needs to be taken care of, all right? Regularly do that. I've done a lot of checkups, but every once in a while, do another one again and try to get it taken care of. In your book also, the first week here, you watch that video. Hopefully you'll watch it before you, in most of our cases anyway, we're watching it before we get to our group, our small group. You can watch it online. Just go to our website and go to small groups. You click on the small groups tab, go down there, and it says watch the video. And all you have to do is a password. It's just the word transformed, capital T. So it's really, really easy to learn, to watch. And his first video for this first week, really good stuff. About a half an hour, really excellent material. But he suggests, and I just put some of that down here in your outline, am I loving God supremely, most of all? Am I meeting with God daily, reading his word, praying, then doing what he shows me to do? It's not just all intellect, right? It's responding to the voice. It's doing what he asks me to do. Am I learning to love other believers? Am I prioritizing him financially, tithing my income to help his cause? Am I serving others unselfishly, seeking his justice and his righteousness so that I walk humbly with God, as Micah 6:8 says? Am I passing on what I'm learning? And then I've added one more. Am I growing in all of these? Because if you're not growing, you're starting to slide, right? Am I growing in all these? Just make sure, if you haven't already gotten into a small group, please get into one, because we can help each other move forward. If you're really serious about making progress in life, you really do best when you're on a team. And so we push each other a whole lot, but I remember when I was running cross country when I was in high school, many years and some pounds ago, but I had this guy always on my shoulder, you know, and I ran so much farther and ran so much harder and increased skill because of a team member, right? Get on a team. Get with your small group. Let's do this together. And just remember, he's going to welcome you with open arms. He takes off your pig-smelling old outfit, you know? I can imagine the father runs up to him and says, oh, son, I'm so glad, but you stink. Somebody get him a new robe. He's got to get out of this pig stink. He's my son. He's got to have something better than this. And the signet ring that had authority so you could sign documents legally and all that. Get some new sandals. Let's party. God wants you back. He loves it when you come back. He loves it when you get with him into transformation. So one more verse. This is the memory verse for this week. Let's read it together. In fact, would you stand up, please, if you can, wherever you're at, and let's read it together. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Let's read it again. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much that you take us back. And you give us a new covering instead of all those cover-ups, instead of that pig stink, instead of all the mess. You call to us. You've called us many, many times, and even though we've oftentimes gone against you and ignored your call, you still call us, Lord. Please help us to get fed up with the mess, with any aspect of our life, any compartment, any department of our lives that's not really there with you. God, help us to get fed up with it. Help us to see it for what it is, for the mess it is. Wake us up. Help us to get up and come to you at the cross. We come to you even right now. And we fess up. We admit it's we who got into the problem. You didn't move. We did. So now, even this morning, we pray the ABC prayer. Lord, we A, admit that we've sinned against you. B, we believe that you do want us back. We believe that you died on the cross for us, Jesus. We believe that what you did covers us completely if we will commit our lives to you, and we do that now. C, we commit. Say, we are yours from this point forward. And we ask you, God, to transform our lives during these 50 days and beyond. If you've never yourself said yes to Jesus, please just do that now. Jesus, I accept your gift of salvation. Thank you for loving me, for dying for me. I give myself back to you. Make me yours. And now, God, whether it's for the first time or whether it's just coming back to you with a part of our life, Lord, now we look forward to being yours and joining the celebration of life that you make possible. Thank you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. All right, you got prayer requests? You got any particular friends in need that you want us to pray about concerning that? Let us know online, in person, whatever. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Shalom. Go with him.